Good morning. Welcome to Unity of Hagerstown. We are so happy that you are here with us this morning. And this next song is reminding you of who you really are. Let's begin with our opening prayer. Taking a nice deep breath as we settle in and center ourselves in that understanding that God is present here and now with every breath we breathe, every beat of our heart. We are one with all that is. We let go of any fear, any confusion, and gain clarity here and now in the realization of this Christ consciousness within us, this higher self, leading us on to greater understanding, deeper compassion, and a life worth living. So it is. Amen. And if you'll join me in our affirmative opening. our mission statement. Together, unity of Hagerstown, a welcoming community, embraces spiritual awakening through affirmative prayer and meditation, creating a positive path of abundant living for all. And now we'll have the reading of the daily word with Barbara.
Closer. Creative. Stunning visual arts, inspirational music, a brilliant performance. These are all lovely examples of creativity, but they are by no means the only ones. Creativity is the very nature of life. From the most soul-inspiring instants to the mundane moments that fill daily life, creative acts abound. Creative activities are prayers in action, a continuation of divine activity in its infinite manifestations. Living is a creative act. It's the way I am in the world, the way I love, and the way I relate to all others. Understanding it in this way, I see how I am using my thoughts, feelings, and imagination to create my experiences. I bring my divine gifts to life through my creativity. And from Genesis 1:26, then God said, let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion. And if together we can say the affirmation, the creative energy of spirit expresses through me. Take a moment, bring that into your heart space. Let the creative energy flow. And one more time.
The creative energy of spirit expresses through me.
Thank you, Barbara. And now we have an opportunity to greet our neighbors. And again, it's just a brief hello, how you doing? Not a life sharing of a life story. But, and I should say, if you would like to say hello to our virtual friends, just come here and say hello. Move a little bit closer, maybe, to so that they can hear you, because there'll be a lot of background noise. I know how you are, and it's all good, you know. So, yeah, let's take a moment. Handshake, hug, or howdy, or namaste, whatever your preference is. So I'm going to say hello to you guys.
Yes, that's good, that's good.
Now
it's okay. Oh, gosh, now I can't get out of my head. Anyway, today we're going to...
Who's Lawrence Welk?
Today, we're going to continue on with our series on affirmative prayer, my friends. This is based on a book by two ministers from New Thought, Reverend Linda Martella Wixett and Reverend Deanne Lear Lawrence. And just to recap a little bit, because you know we've been going through this book now for about 3 weeks, affirmative prayer is not begging, beseeching, or pleading with the God out there. It is knowing that we are one with Spirit, and all the qualities of Spirit are within us. And through affirmations, which are short, concise statements of the truth of our being, our spiritual truth, we can claim these qualities and bring them forth into our daily life so that we make this relevant, this spiritual path relevant for us. Okay, so we not only use affirmations, but we also use denials or negations to negate the power of limited thinking. Is that pretty, do I need to expound on that? Okay, good. Okay, good, that sounds great. So those limited thoughts, or those thoughts of unworthiness, I'm gonna expound just a little bit. We can get caught up in them. So we use those negations to release them, to let them go, to let them know they have no power over this person here, right? So today we're gonna take a little bit deeper dive into the nature of God for 15 minutes. I always laugh because it's like, yeah, I mean, people study years for this, but we're gonna do it in 15 minutes, right? because how we think about God determines how we pray, right? And I'm sure that you have noticed in your life, your thoughts about God may have changed, they may have grown out of the God of your childhood to another understanding now. In fact, Martella Whitsett tells us we evolve our God consciousness by paying attention to what we were taught to believe and what we are being invited to understand. So we examine the teachings that we were raised with, perhaps, or what others have told us, and listen to the understanding of our heart so that the God that we talk about now not only appeals to our intellect, but to our heart as well. It makes understanding. So that God is perhaps no longer seen as a being up in the sky, but rather the quality of beingness. God is no longer a Charlton Heston who loves us, but love itself. Do you see the difference? Okay. So, since we are human, though, we tend to experience the divine through a human lens, through our human experience. And there are different perspectives that we may have adopted, but we might be invited to adopt as far as the divine goes. We can recognize God as transcendent, all that is. Perhaps when you're at the beach and looking at the ocean, you feel this transcendent, you know, sacred spirit. And this is really the God that we may talk about. We can also see God as the beloved, perhaps as Buddha or Jesus or our next door neighbor who is just shining forth with such a spiritual light. And this might be the God that we talk with. And then there is the God that is within us, immanent. In fact, in unity, Martella Whitsett tells us, we do not pray to a deity that we consider outside of us. Our relating to God is instead how we see and relate to the divinity we experience within ourselves and others. It is the relational understanding of God that invites us to be in service, to pray with others, and to connect. So, The understanding of God within us lets us realize that all of those qualities we associate with the divine are where? They're within us. They're everywhere, right? So we can tap into that. And that's what affirmative prayer does. It helps us tap into it. No separation, only oneness. No separation, only oneness. So Martella Whitsett in Weir Warrensey tells us the I am fuels the power and impact of affirmative prayer. It is how we claim, activate, and inhabit what we recognize about God. It is how we move from a God we talk about to standing in our divine identity. So this I am that we use in affirmative prayer also could be considered the higher self or the Christ consciousness. It is actually our spiritual nature, that is what we're going to think of it as opposed to our human expression. So keep in mind, though, my friends, there is no wrong way to pray. It is according to our understanding. And if we have outgrown the prayers of our youth, then it's time to examine how we pray. So God that is the cosmos, the transcendent God, God that is the experience of each other, God that is immanent. We're not talking about three gods. This is all one. It's just how we experience the divine. Okay, so we may naturally lean into one of these perspectives more than the others. You know, so, and that's great, you know, but it does give us the opportunity to look at the other perspectives as well so that we can grow our understanding of an infinite spirit. So in unity, we also say that God is principle. That means God is unchanging, definable rules of action, if you will, unchanging though. So we no longer think of God as a personality to be persuaded by our prayers, or a God that is vengeful at times and other times is, you know, blessing us. God is unchanging. God is unchanging principle. I'm sure you've heard of the story of David and Goliath. David, as a young man, went to face this seasoned warrior, very big person, with only a slingshot and a couple of stones, a handful of stones. Well, we all have our own inner Goliaths that we can face through some of what David brought to that battle. The faith in God within us, the strength of God within us. In fact, Charles Fillmore, co-founder of Unity, identified 12 powers that we all have. And here they are listed. I don't know if you can see that. Imagination, faith, zeal, power, strength, life, will, understanding, love. I can't read that one.
Wisdom,
thank you. Order and release. And of course, there are other powers or principles that are available to us, such as beauty, peace, joy. Yeah. So we use these principles in affirmative prayer in order to bring them forth in our lives. We claim them because they're there already. We claim them. We affirm we are that principle because in our spiritual reality, we are. So we claim them to activate them so that we might embody them. This is the essence of affirmative prayer, recognizing that God, that principle, is, and it's available to us so that we can make that useful in our lives. So these principles are also found in human expression as well as a spiritual level. And let me just give you a quick example of that. Love. We may fall in love with somebody, and then time goes by, we fall out of love with somebody. That's a human experience. That's a human expression of that principle of love. The spiritual principle of love is never changing. Love is, period. I am love, period. Never changing. Okay? So, I've kind of gotten off course. That's okay. We'll just move to the next slide. let's see. Charles Fillmore says, when declaring I am within spiritual practice, we are acting from spiritual authority, activating spiritual power, dwelling on truth so intently that every dimension of being realizes it. Let's go over that again. When we use our I am love, very simple one, we are acting from spiritual authority. We are activating that power within us. And as we focus on that, it comes into every aspect of our life. Sounds good, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So Fillmore goes on to say, your real self is that which says, I am. It cannot be described because description is limitation. And your real self is unlimited in its capacity to be. It is the all possibility. If I am one with spirit, I am unlimited. This is kind of a big thing to grasp, right? I am unlimited, when, especially when circumstances may seem contrary to that. But stop and think, I am unlimited in my capacity to love. I am unlimited in my capacity to be peace no matter what's going on around me. I am unlimited in deepening my understanding of not only my spiritual nature, but of the nature of God as well. Okay. So I want to tell you a story. This is a true story. And I absolutely love this. I came across this. I had never heard of it before, but a man named Harry DeMayer was going to an auction one snowy evening in 1956. It was a horse auction, and by the time he got there, because he was running late, I guess, because of the snow, all the good horses had already been sold. And the few that had remained were just sold off to a little bidder for salvage. Harry was a riding master at a girls' school in New York, and he was about to leave one of the horses that had been sold to the low bidder, a gray gelding with wounds on his legs and deep harness scars that showed that he was used as a plow horse for most of his life, kind of caught his eye. And Harry didn't know what it was about this horse, but he approached the bidder and offered him $80 for the horse. And the man said, sure, take the horse. So Harry takes the horse home, and because it was snowing, when he arrived home, the horse was covered in snow, and his children saw the horse for the first time and immediately called him Snowman. Yeah. So Harry took good care of the horse, you know, really good care. The horse started improving, and Snowman turned out to be a very reliable and steady ride. He wasn't spooky, you know. He didn't spook at things. The girls liked to ride him, you know, because he was so steady. In fact, Snowman made such rapid improvement under Harry's care that a neighbor offered to buy him for twice what Harry had bought him for. And Harry was thinking, well, that's a pretty good deal. So he sold Snowman. But Snowman did not want to stay at the neighbor's. And he would end up in, you know, pastures around. He would end up back at Harry's as well. And the only thing Harry could figure is that Snowman was jumping the fences. It would look really unlikely because of the condition that he was in and his age. He was 8 years old at the time. And Harry had never seen Snowman jump anything more than, I thought, maybe a log that was falling on the ground. Eventually, the neighbor's patience ran out. And he insisted that Harry take back this horse because he couldn't keep him. You know, for years, Harry had a dream of producing a champion jumping horse. And he had moderate success in the past, but in order to really compete at the highest levels, he knew he'd have to buy a pedigreed horse that had been specifically bred to jump. And that kind of pedigree comes at a pretty high price, right? More than what Harry could afford. But Snowman was showing that he liked to jump. So Harry said, let's let him jump. And so he did. Eventually, he had a chance to enter him into a competition. That's a picture of him there. And in 1958, his snowman was standing among the beautifully bred pedigree horses in all of his wonderful glory. You know, his looking a little bit out of place, perhaps. But snowman won. Harry continued to enter him into competitions. Snowman continued to win. Audiences cheered every time Snowman won, because it was so unlikely. But he became a symbol of how extraordinary an ordinary horse can be. And he appeared on television. Books were written about him. I think a movie was made of him, too. As Snowman continued to win, someone offered Harry $100,000 for this horse. Harry said no. Mm-hmm. At that time, he would not sell. In 1958 and 59, Snowman was named Horse of the Year. Mm-hmm. I had no idea there was such a thing, right? And here's another thing I didn't know about. He was inducted in the Show Jumping Hall of Fame. Another thing, So for many, Snowman was much more than a horse. He became an example of the hidden, untapped potential within all of us. There is a part of us within us, our I am, our true self, that wants to let the extraordinary out into our ordinary lives, my friends. We do that by attaching that I am with those spiritual qualities. To say that I am one with God may feel like it's just too big to chew, right? But we can say, I am one with peace. I am one with love. And let that love flow through us. Whatever situation you are currently facing, there is a spiritual quality that can help you move through it. Charles Fillmore tells us, I am is the gate through which my thoughts come forth from the invisible. And it is through this gate that I go to get into the presence of Spirit. And that's what we're going to do right here and now. Get into the presence of Spirit. Although I would like to edit that a little bit. We're going to become aware of the presence of Spirit here and now within us all around. So to begin with, let's go ahead and state this affirmation together. I am the presence of peace. And as we get comfortable in our seats, perhaps closing our eyes, begin to follow your breath. I am the presence of peace. Let us let go of anything that tells us differently. Let us let go of the fear, confusion, or any conflict we may be holding on to. And if we can't release them, let us at least know that they have no power over us, except for that which we give them, those thoughts. And here now, we can refuse to let them have any more power. And turning within to that presence of peace that is always with us, that is always our true self, our true essence. Silently affirming, I am the presence of peace, here and now. I allow this peace to flow through me today. With everyone I see, everyone I greet, every conversation, I remain peaceful. choosing not to react. Being mindful of my words, I am the presence of peace. And as we go into a time of quiet, use that affirmation as a vehicle to go deeper into meditation, as an anchor for your thoughts as well. And if you find your thoughts drifting off, I invite you to be gentle with yourself and know that that's okay. Thoughts do that. And just bring your attention back. I am the presence of peace. I am the presence of peace in the silence. I am is the gate through which my thoughts come forth from the invisible, and it is through this gate that I go to be the presence of spirit. And as we bring our meditation time to a close, if you want to sit restfully throughout the next song, I invite you to do so, or join in.
There is one love. Through me, spirit move through me.
for that, right? Or in, I don't know, through me, I don't know what it would be. But somebody creative can do that, okay? Now for our announcements. Ta-da! Just kidding, there are some announcements. First of all, Friday, November 1st, we are having a Knitting with Love prayer shawl ministry gathering. If you're interested, please see Amy Bennett, and that's at 1 p.m. Sunday, November 3rd, a pre-election special service, Taze service, so that we might get all centered, okay? Let's get all centered and not worry about it. And just, yeah. So if that interests you, we'll have, the order of service will be the same, but instead of me talking, it'll be a Taze service for about 30 minutes. Okay? First Wednesday of every month is our sound bath. $25 gets you a whole lot of healing. And then, the next cleanup day for St. Mark's is November 9th, 10 a.m. Thank you for all who came yesterday and worked so, so beautifully. Three different congregations were here working on this campus, and it was really nice to partner with each one of them. And we got it done pretty quickly. So St. Mark sent me a thank you note to thank this community for the work that they did. And then on Sunday, the second Sunday of the month, Universal Dances of Peace at 1 p.m. If you want to come to this and you want to come to the 11 o'clock service, please bring your lunch and we'll just have a little lunch in between the two events. This is, I think Jen's doing the music for that, right?
Not that one, December.
Oh, okay. Kathy told me something about it. Okay, very good. But there's live music, those dances are really a sacred activity, you know, using sacred chants and texts from all the world faith traditions. And then Saturday the 16th is Doug Kinney's Celebration of Life service. That will begin at 11 a.m. with a reception, followed by the service at noon, just so that you can mark that on your calendars if you want. Zion Soup Kitchen. Oh, why did I pass this around? If you're able to help prepare anything, looks like we need a few things here. If you're able to help contribute, that'd be great. Thank you, Bill. And that will be coming up the first Tuesday of the month. The quilt that we have hanging up in the hallway, that raffle ends today. If you want it, you better bid on it. If not, Debbie's walking home with it, and which would be fine too. We are looking for a bylaw tee. If you just love getting into the nitty gritty of bylaws, and that really just is your thing. I mean, there are some people who love it, and we would like a team to come. Unity Worldwide Ministries has sent us a new template. We want to look at it before we adopt it and compare it to our current bylaws. So please let Ann Baker, president of the board, or myself know if you are interested. And if you have a gift in looking at details like that, that would be great.
Fabulous.
What's it?
Fabulous,
that's right, fabulous. So at this point, we're going to say goodbye to our Facebook friends, and thank you so much for being part of this community. We appreciate your presence. We appreciate your donations. We love you. We bless you.